Welcome back, everybody, to the MSI Fnatic Beat It Global. We are getting into our last games for the Middle Eastern qualifier. It is the last two best of threes. The winners will be able to go to Dubai. The losers, sadly, well, they can still go, just not as players. So it's going to be our first match of the day is going to be For the Glory versus Terra Firma Esports, which is, of course, Mad's new all-French team. They actually are not all-French for this match, nor any of the matches from the Middle Eastern qualifier, because they're going to be running with two stand-ins from the region. So as we jump into this, guys, I can go ahead and welcome in my co-caster. This time, no audio issues on my part. So welcome, Naz.
Well, thanks, man. Good morning. This should be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to casting Mad and. I keep wanting to call him Sakshi. I guess I should call him Paris, but I probably will slip into the old habits. These are two of my favorite players to watch. I really, you know, I probably get flamed for this, but I really firmly believe that if Sigma had stayed together last year, that they would have been at TI4 and that they would have made some noise. They were a really fun team to watch. Sakshi, for a period of time, was the most flexible one position player in the game. He had a stretch of about 25 games where he played something like 22 different heroes. I mean, that's more than Mushi at TI3, and he still owns some farm records on some fairly random heroes, including Centaur Warrunner. He actually has a 674 GPM game on Centaur in a win over Liquid back this past spring, and that's the highest GPM ever set on Centaur Warrunner in Pro Dota 2. And this is a combination, Wisp and Centaur, that Sigma did used to run. So I think this should be a really neat game.
Wow, I can't believe that he's still... I mean, that is an insanely high gold per minute for a Centaur. That is crazy, because at a certain point, a Centaur is supposed to start dropping off, and he's no longer supposed to, like, keep getting kills. He still initiates, and he still stuns and everything else, but he doesn't, like, pop heroes usually. And he ends up usually falling to, like, a lot of the AoE, since he's the initiator, but... So that's surprising to hear that. It was such a massive GPM. But yeah, I mean, I wouldn't worry too much about calling him Paris or Sakshi. Honestly, every cast, I have to make a point of calling him both of the names so people do know who Paris is, while at the same time trying to give him his due, since he obviously wants to change his name completely. But we do have to talk about the draft here. Lycan, Skywrath Mage, Bristleback, and Enigma, all being banned away by For the Glory. Tinker, Doom, Nyx Assassin, and Faceless Void banned out by Terra Firma Esports. Brewmaster and Lynch was picked up as 1-2 for the Glory with Centaur, and now the Tiny is going to go the way of Terra Firma. So as you said earlier, that Wisp Centaur is a combination that they've run before. They now have the primary Wisp hero partner, which is going to be the Tiny, but of course I prefer to see lineups where the Wisp is able to utilize more than one hero, which means that just because a Tiny is on map doesn't mean you aren't threatened by a relocate, because the Wiz could be joining with a Centaur who may be off map. You know, those sort of things. I prefer to see those sort of situations for a Wiz. It opens up the gameplay a lot more.
Yeah, I really agree. And, you know, of course, Murphy's Law, I made a big deal out of Sakshi's record on Centaur, and he's probably going to be on the Tiny, actually. Yeah. He has a couple of over 800 GPM games on Tiny. The Lich pick, I actually really like. I am not, in general, a fan of Lich, but this is a point that I've made in some previous casts. Lich actually has had a lot of success in recent games as a dual mid, as a counter to Wisp dual mid lanes, and a tiny Wisp especially is one of those that you really look for. So I do think the Lich pick to go along with the Brewmaster is really smart. I don't mind the Viper either. I think that Viper gives you a very, very strong option in 1v1 lanes, especially if the other team is going to go greedy, as Terra Firma look like they're doing, picking up the Death Prophet next. So, I mean, right now, what it looks like is that you're going to have that Viper 1v1 likely up against either the Centaur or the Death Prophet, and that's a lane that they can really try to take advantage of.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there are, at the same time, I think that the Death Prophet is one of the few mids who can do, not like win the lane up against Viper, but he can do decently well, which is you just spam out your Q every once in a while. It's one of those, like any of the mids that focuses on CS, right? So the Death Prophet, like I think one of the only melees who can actually go up against Viper is a Dragonite, because you sit back there and you just spam your fire. You're still going to lose the lane most likely, but The important part is just like not dying and focusing on CS, in which case the Death Prophet is perfect for that, right? She just spams out her Q. She doesn't have to worry about the right-click damage that the Viper is going to have over her when it comes to CSing, because she's just going to spam out her Crypt Swarm. Now the Witch Doctor is going to be grabbed by For the Glory, though, and that is a hero that is kind of curious because we haven't really seen Witch Doctor picked up a whole lot outside of either really, really early push drafts or all around the Faces 4.
So I really like the Witch Doctor pick, and I'll tell you why. What you were saying about Death Prophet versus Viper is exactly right in a 1v1 situation. But here's the thing. Even though she is going to hold her own in a 1v1 against that Viper, either she or the Centaur, they still might choose to send him mid, although I doubt it. Both of them are going to fall behind in experience. And what that does is it lets roaming supports be that much more effective. That Death Prophet, remember, at the beginning of the game, she is really, really slow with that 285 base move speed. So that Viper gets a level advantage on her, and that Witch Doctor and maybe even another roaming support can come in and do really, really well in terms of keeping her down. That's the thing with Viper in the mid. It's not just the 1v1 matchups. It's the fact that he can get that lead early on and really open up the map for those support rotations against a hero like Death Prophet that really does want to control runes in order to support that Crypt Swarm spam that she needs.
Mm-hmm. 10 seconds. Well, then, in that case, what do you think about the last support pickup here for Terra Firma? Are they going to go for a support that can they actually go dual lanes here? Can maybe the Wisp, I don't want to see the tiny Wisp going up against the Viper, but can like maybe the Wisp sit with the Death Prophet? If this lane's going to be such a tragedy for the Death Prophet with the Viper and the Witch Doctor making movements around, putting pressure on her, can we see maybe the Wisp supporting the Death Prophet, not really trying to soak up too much experience, but maybe doing the Radiant thing, which is, you know, you just stack up some of the creeps from the side camp and do that whole thing so that the Tiny or Centaur or anyone else can farm up later. And you're just there as a protective, you know, when you need it, the Wisp will be there to be able to help you out, and then in which case you just have a support with the Tiny, which is still enough to probably threaten whoever is going to be going to the offlane for the Glory.
Yeah, I think that's what – there are two things that you can do here, right? So the one, assuming that he's not already been banned, which is actually a little bit surprising, you can think about going a Shadow Shaman here and just going full-out aggressive. Never rule out Bane. When Matt is in the game, he is just an excellent, excellent Bane player. I think since, you know, PPD probably holds that crown right now, but he's excellent on that hero. Mm-hmm. I think a Mirana would make a lot of sense here too, to sort of try and counter that roaming. But yeah, I would tend to go with you, and there you go. You pick up that really strong lane support, that Keeper of the Light, that's going to discourage that kind of aggression and is going to be able to help control the lane equilibrium and take advantage of those jungle camps on the Radiant side.
So stacking, definitely a priority, I feel, for Terra Firma now with that Caudle pickup. For the Glory, though, their lanes are a bit of a mystery for me, just because like the Viper is obviously going mid, but are they going to be doing dual lanes here? The Witch Doctor and a Brewmaster is one position, or is this an offlane brew and that is going to be paired up with the Lich? Offlane Brewmaster is viable. We've seen it in the past, and with Lich as a support, you know, bringing the lane back via those denies, I think he's maybe even more viable, in which case they can run a harder carry as their one position.
See, if it's me, okay, and they probably will send the Viper mid, you're probably right, but if I'm laning this, I actually try to get the Brew and Lich dual mid against the Tiny and Wisp. I think that's a lane that can win. And I really like the last pick's Juggernaut. I think, obviously, Terra Firma is going to be the favorites in this series, but I think that For the Glory have given themselves a chance here with this lineup. This Juggernaut is a sustainable hero in a dual lane with a Witch Doctor who's going to do some roaming. He's going to get his XP. I think they can put a lot of pressure on that, and what you're really trying to do here is I think you're trying to isolate the Viper in a 1v1 situation up against either the Centaur or the Death Prophet on one of the side lanes. And then you've got the Caudle with whichever hero doesn't get the solo lane going up against the Witch Doctor and the Juggernaut. I think For the Glory actually has a very good shot at winning the laning phase in this match.
Yeah, I agree. I think they definitely picked up very strong laners between the Viper and the Juggernaut. The supports, especially the Lich, I feel is a good way to be able to make sure your offlane does really well. And I think that is going to transition into... I don't think there's going to be an opportunity here for Terra Firma, or at least there shouldn't, for them to be able to utilize early exorcisms to take towers, because For the Glory should be able to come away from the laning phase either okay or winning, And that will turn them into a very strong early to mid-game lineup. I mean, between the Brewmaster, if he can get a Blink Dagger, decent timing, we'll have to see, because he's apparently going to be running the offlane here. Viper is going to have a mech. Juggernaut is amazing during that point in time where your spin is still very deadly, but at the same time, nobody has escape mechanisms. Your Omni Slash still does a lot of work as well. So I think there shouldn't be any opportunities for Terra Firma to take towers. And then on the reverse side, it actually should be for the Glory, who can probably lay down some pressure. They don't have amazing pushers, but they do have amazing amount of sustain between the Juggernaut Healing Ward mixed in with the mech. They could probably take some towers and start laying down some pressure. My concern is they won't be able to push fast enough in order to keep this Tiny in check. Like, I don't think Paris is going to be that big of a threat. Like the Death Prophet early pushes with Exorcism. I think this is going to be much more of a mid-game oriented Death Prophet and none of those early pushes. But I'm more concerned about where this Tiny is going to go. With the room offered to him, I just don't think they're going to be able to push down towers fast enough that the that the Tiny will be able to have a lot of room. But we'll see how Nahaz responds to that as soon as our Skype call is fixed.
There we go.
Much better. Early wards being laid down by the Lich, though. He just laid an aggressive ward to be able to see Rune Vision and see those kind of rotations from the supports. But at the same time, that was immediately spotted out. And as soon as they have money for a counter ward, in fact, Wisp already does if he wants to buy it right now, they'll be able to counter that right away.
Yeah, and that's a big advantage. I mean, this is now that we're starting to see some of this heat map data with wards in games like this, vision advantages, and part of this is due to snowballing, but vision advantages do tend to be really persistent. And I think a lot of people underestimate, if you find one or two of those opponents' obs wards at the beginning of the game, that really is a very, very big deal. And they should find this ward here, although they're not necessarily going to have vision up there of the high ground. We were talking, though, about for the Glorious lineup, and the real risk that I see is that we had this issue in a couple of games that I cast yesterday with Pimp Muckle. The Lich pick, and also to some extent the Juggernaut and the Brewmaster, these are heroes where if they don't, and the Viper, these are heroes where if they don't have a good laning phase, they can really get into a situation where they're just not bringing anything to the table. So the pressure is definitely on for the Glory to execute in this laning phase.
I like the fact they're running the Juggernaut here as the offlane paired up with the Lich going against the Tiny, because the Tiny is so threatened by the spin. He's not so tanky that he can just deal with a full spin like that. And this is going to put a lot more opening for the Brewmaster. Hold on, Mango's taking a huge amount of damage here. Gets off the stomp, finally levels it. Witch Doctor was able to take advantage there of the invis and actually get a really good cast that allowed them to burn through Centaur's whole entire potion there. So that's a great way to start the lane already. But the Brewmaster is going to be able to pick up a very fast blink here. And that was my concern if they ran Brewmaster as the offlane. He wouldn't get the Blink Dagger fast enough to ensure that this, again, this Death Prophet wouldn't be able to take any of those tier 1 towers.
Yeah, and I'm going to stand by my original statement. I think actually that Terra Firma would have been better off laning the Tiny Wisp dual mid against the Viper. That lane played correctly can really, really hurt the Viper. We're going to have a little bit of contesting of these camps in the Radiant Jungle. I think this is really smart. Terra Firma have gone extremely greedy with the way they've chosen to lane this, trying to have both the Wisp and the Caudal stacking up the jungle here, and they need to try and make them pay for this if possible. Again, the early Blink Dagger on the Brewmaster, as you said before, is a big part of how they're going to do that.
At the same time, Mango, well, he shouldn't be too bad. Apparently, he got the lane in a really good position with his block, and it's sitting right in front of his tower pretty consistently. So he's going to have a good amount of experience from this lane and even a couple of right clicks. The lane is dangerous, to be sure. I mean, Brewmaster is not to be trifled with in the laning phase due to the power of that guaranteed crit mixed in with a very, very nice slow. But I think you should be able to grab a lot of experience, and that will mean they can get the Centaur ultimate up nice and early. And that is a very good disengaging ability against all of For the Glory, between whether it's the Juggernaut spin or the Viper's pursuit or even the Panda's clap. For me personally, Centaur is one of the ultimate counters to a Brewmaster, because a Brewmaster initiates, he hits the slow first, and then he pops the ultimate. But that takes some serious time, and a Centaur ultimate will get you enough distance out of the way 90% of the time that the Brewmaster ultimate is kind of negated.
Yeah, that's very true. And I mean, For the Glory just doesn't have a lot in the way of hard disables. I mean, that cask, obviously well placed, can really really wreck a team in a fight, but they don't have much in the way of single target hard disable. And I do think that you're starting to see this the laning strategy pay off from Terra Firma. They're getting levels on all of their cores. The Centaur is about to hit level 4 here with this next wave incoming to his tower. So yeah, they should get their levels up, and I think this laning phase, they're gonna definitely have done what they wanted to do in a laning phase where on paper I do think they had a disadvantage.
Yeah, this Viper is feeling the pain right now. I'm surprised he didn't go, I think this is a mistake, the extra level in poison attack, where I believe it should be corrosive skin. I mean, most Vipers are going corrosive skin maxed out anyway, but up against a magic damage dealer like this Death Prophet is, who's constantly spamming out the Crypt Swarms, you have even more incentive to get that extra magic resistance.
Well, and you've got a build here with a 3 points on poison attack that looks like it's heavily focused on harassment, and he's just not been doing much harassing. And the other thing that you need to make a harassing build like that maximally effective is you need rune control. And as you're seeing, the Wisp is already rotated up to secure this regen rune and the bot rune spot for the Death Prophet. So any harassment that's going to come out from that 3 points in poison attack is pretty much going to be negated by the fact that the Radiant side are going to have rune control.
Yeah, you're right. This Viper is just completely SOL at this point in time, but from his skill build and that regen especially. Obviously, the best rune that a Death Prophet can get about this point in time. Viper is beginning to go on Paris, and he can go for the dive here, but if he doesn't actually get the kill, the regen will just heal everything back up, and sure enough, Paris gets into the trees and is now going to be able to burn that regen and go right back up to full. Oh, the regen is actually intercepted there. Nicely played by the Viper, but he still has a full bottle on the side of Paris, and he's going to still have that big advantage over the Viper.
Yeah, I think that cancellation of the regen rune is still a really big deal though, because they both had the bottles going at this point, and the regen rune would have made it so that Death Prophet would have been full HP, full mana with a full bottle against a Viper that was having to bottle crow back. So I actually still think that could be a pretty big deal. She is ahead on CS here, but this is the time really where the Viper should be taking the lead in this lane.
Yeah, the moment he hits level 6 especially has that additional slow, and we'll have to keep an eye on it. But at the same time, the Centaur was forced away from his offlane. And the reason why he was forced away, Witch Doctor went for a very offensive build here, went for a 1-0-2, maxing out the Maledict, where primarily Witch Doctors are trying to max out Voodoo Restoration nowadays. It's been buffed up so many times.
I really like what the Witch Doctor is doing in this game. We have seen the power of that max W build on Witch Doctor, the max heal build displayed. Milos ran that in a couple of games and really just pushed the heck out of the map with that build. But they don't necessarily on the dire side, although Juggernaut's got that healing ward as well, okay? They don't necessarily have a heavy push lineup here. And so I really like what Witch Doctor is doing. They're gonna need damage. Tiny may be in trouble in the bot lane, but no, he's away just in time.
Yeah, Juggernaut doesn't even have upgraded boots at this point, so
oh,
they need the additional slow.
Here.
Yeah, Lich completely caught out of position there, and they're actually going to go for an additional one onto the Juggernaut with the Wisp joining the Tiny. If they can get a toss, they can kill Juggernaut here. The toss up, a single right click, another one. Wisp will be able to seal the deal. Jor-El walks away from a nice little two kill. Meanwhile, at the same time, Viper was actually able to catch the Death Prophet as Paris apparently was going for the bottom rune, I presume.
Yeah, that's a couple of mistakes now by Paris, but really kind of inexplicable plays there by For the Glory. Scorp's Lich sort of just deciding to take a jaunt over the side shop against a Tiny that should have most of his combo up here. And then the Juggernaut running to the side in front of his tower. I thought he might have been able to get away if he just went straight ahead. The Tiny didn't. I don't think he had enough mana for both Avalanche and Toss there. So a little bit of a misplay, I feel, that led to two. And that's just huge.
Yeah, combined with the fact that the Tiny was already going to be super farmed because of the way that he's able to just clear through camps when he has the Keeper of the Light. You can see him doing it now. He cleared through the hard camp stack and is now farming up the other camps because he's got infinite mana and the combo is so much damage. You waste very, very little time in the jungle and he can come right back to mid lane. You can see him trying to catch out the Lich. And they can actually maybe go on the Tiny here as long as the Lich doesn't get hit by the stun. He does, though. And with a right click, they will be able to finish him off. And without a slow, Jarrell will just walk away from the Juggernaut, who still does not have those phase boots yet.
Yeah, and it's really just critical right now that the Juggernaut doesn't have his level 6 yet, because he could really, he could at least keep them back with the threat of the Omni Slash. Even those three jumps, like you said, can be, can make a really big difference, because Tiny is still sitting at one armor. But yeah, I mean, until he hits his level 6 and really has the phase boots, that Juggernaut is in a situation where he has to be really careful. And if he's not careful here, he's going to give up another kill to the Invis rune of Sakshka.
Sakshka, unfortunately, does not go for an early level of silence, nor do you as a Death Prophet this early on. But it would be nice if they could initiate on the Juggernaut and make sure that he isn't able
Dire's
to spin
bottom tower is under attack.
And combine that with the Avalanche initiation. Doesn't look like Paris is going to find much here. He does reveal the Viper's rotation over, and they need to start getting out now, and that's why the Centaur Ultimate is going to be used. But, oh wow, Juggernaut, Omni Slash hit on two there, but Babar was able to get away just barely.
Oh!
The stun comes down. They're going to be able to hit both the Witch Doctor as well as the Juggernaut. Meanwhile, Sakshka's going to be coming in from behind, releasing that Exorcism, cleaning up a second one in the Lich. Exorcism goes out, and it's going to be able to do a good amount to the Viper, who's going to be tossed up in the air by Jarrell and beaten down. Double kill for Jarrell, and Paris picks up a nice little kill as well. He's trying to catch up to the Witch Doctor, but I don't think he's really going to be able to do this. He's diving in deep with those phase boots. The last hit, Crypt Swarm barely off the mark there. And Neil's dying just to the tower here. That last hit is actually going to be able to finish him off. Healing Salve keeps him alive.
Now he's got the ghost back.
10 health. And the ghosts are going to be able to regen him back up to full.
Well, my friend, there is a fine line between a bait and a feed, and I really did think during that last fight that Babar's Wisp coming back in range of the paralyzing cast from the Witch Doctor might have turned that fight before the glory. He was, that Wisp at the very beginning of the fight was almost dead. He was down below about 30 health, but they were able to turn around there and get Tiny in more kills in lane. Tiny is now sitting at 4-0-1 at the 10-minute mark, and that is just absolutely terrifying if you're playing against a Tiny.
Oh yeah, at this point in time, Tiny, he's gonna have I don't know why he's stacking up so much gold on himself right now. Most Tinies would be like finishing up the wand, getting a drums, and then start building into the Aghanim Scepter. It almost seems like Jarrell is just gonna go straight for the Ags because he's stacking so much gold unnecessarily.
Yeah, okay, quick disconnect from the Lich, so we'll have a pause here to talk about it for a minute. Yeah, I definitely am a fan of early drums on Tiny. I mean, the win rate on that drums into Ags build on a Tiny when you can get it up soon, it's just incredible. I mean, he's got, when he gets drums and Ags up in a reasonable time, like before 20 minutes, he's got something like a 75% win rate. It's crazy. The problem with Tiny is obviously he is really susceptible to a bad laning phase. He's almost like, you know, we talked about it. We've talked about it a little bit over the last few days when we've seen these offlane faceless voids like Sings in that last match. That giving early kills to an offlane faceless void is just so huge. It's really even bigger than First Blood, because that's just not a hero that is supposed to be getting kills in lane. Tiny is the same way. This is not a hero that really should be getting kills, okay, if you're laning properly against him and giving him 4 kills before the 10-minute mark. That's just, he can build whatever item he wants right now, really.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, I mean, if he wants to, he could have gone for, like, the Blink Dagger build and be, like, ultra-aggressive, knowing that he's so far ahead he can pop anybody he jumps on. Paris is going to be gone on here for a second there by the Viper, but he decides against it. I think if the Witch Doctor went the cask into a Maledict, and they could have easily killed the Death Prophet there. But I forgot, he picked up a Haste Rune at the bottom lane during the beginning of that pause, so.
Yeah, a little bit unfortunate. I think if I'm remembering correctly, Scorp was the same player that was having trouble with his electricity getting into the lobby. So hopefully that's going to clear itself up and we'll be able to finish the game here 5-on-5. You know, it's funny. The Viper was able to get that solo kill up on the Death Prophet and looked like he was going to be able to come back in lane. But if you look at it now, Death Prophet still has the CS lead. And that really, you know, I know Crypt Swarm spam is really good, but that really shouldn't happen. Death Prophet in what's basically been a 1v1 lane, and in fact, I think Death Prophet has spent more time away from lane rotating up behind the Tier 1 tower for a possible gank on Juggernaut than Viper has. There's no real reason why the Viper should be trailing right now.
Yeah, I would agree with that. and Viper is suffering from the lack of CS that he has because he doesn't have a mech yet. And he at the very least, like a buckler would add in a lot more survivability. And it showed the last time he was dealing with that exorcism damage, the exorcist was actually doing quite a bit to him just because he didn't have the armor to be able to tank it. Mango, meanwhile, he's been having a fun little time at the top lane. There's no reason for a Centaur to move out. He's got his ultimate, which can help out his team in some of those team fights as we saw the last time they disengaged from that bottom tier one tower. And he can just sit here in the top lane and farm up until he has Dire's a Blink Dagger. And that's going to be up here attack. In just a minute or two, unless For the Glory makes some sort of rotations. But they just aren't right now. Brewmaster has been farming up the jungle in the last minute here. He's got his Blink Dagger. And we'll see what he picks up, if he's going to be going for the treads here or the arcane boots. Because we all know Brewmaster has some serious mana issues, which is why treads or arcanes are the preferable build. But I would say treads are more likely to be seen on a one position Brewmaster.
Yeah, but unfortunately, we've really gotten into that very problematic state for For the Glory that we talked about after the draft. Dire's Tiny is about 30 is gold attack. Away from finishing his Aghanim Scepter at 12 minutes. And the problem is, this is like we were saying, that if the Viper doesn't get his farm up in lane, if the Lich doesn't effectively protect the carry in lane or go dual mid, these two heroes just don't do that much at this point in the game. And now you're counting on a Brewmaster who has that early Blink Arcanes, but what is there really to follow him up? That Omni Slash is still level one. It's going to be level one now for some time. I really am worried in terms of For the Glory's ability to really do anything in an engagement right now. And you give them another couple of minutes and Tiny is going to have another item past his Aghanim. That is so... Whoa, hello. Hello, Brewmaster.
Well, that, I mean, he just showed off his intentions, not only the fact that he has that Blink Dagger plus Arcanes, but the fact that he's trying to move around and gank the map. I mean, you would kind of expect it for a Brewmaster at this point. One position Brewmaster shouldn't be AFK in lane for too long, but still, that was a bit of a blunder by him. And my biggest concern is still, like, Mango's just going to hold on to that ultimate. And the Brewmaster, who's going to be the main initiator and main source of damage right here, is going to be completely destroyed by a swift disengage with that max movement speed. I'm not sure how they're really going to be able to lock down these heroes. Even the cast stun is still a missile, a very slow one, that you can outpace, right? Like, just like the Brewmaster's missile, his first stun comes out from the Earth Panda. You throw that rock, it's still a missile. So even if you do hit it in a short amount of time, they hit that max movement speed, they're still going to get some serious distance on you. And that could be enough that you aren't able to make a further pursuit. So I just don't, like, I was behind the Brewmaster as a one position, but they needed to put more effort into shutting down in top lane. Stomp into Avalanche. Easy.
And they didn't even need the relocate, really.
No.
Centaur had him down to almost no health just with his spell combo alone, but it makes sense. They're going to push this tower now. And yeah, I mean, what you said about the Centaur ult is really 100% dead on. You really have to have some level of AoE lockdown against a Centaur, and that's part of why you saw Centaur fall off a little bit after he was so big in the metagame for a while, because... here we go. Big engagement top. They should get the Tiny here.
Yeah, this is going to be an easy kill for them. But oh, what a turnaround! The toss into three and the stomp follow-up. Lich is almost down. Juggernaut's actually survived through this. Oh, the Crypt Swarm puts a stop to that one. Mango should fall, actually. We're going to have Brewmaster keep on going forward. Forget about that kill. He wants to kill Soxia, who's currently being healed up by the Wisp as much as possible while that Exorcism goes around, but eventually he will fall. Nice Tornado to put a stop to that one, but a big Caudal Blast will finish off the Viper. Now the Brewmaster Ultimate, how effective can it be? He's going to go for the fucking mad, but the Centaur Stomp will stop the heal, and actually Mango, one hit! Brewmaster finally does get the critical to be able to put a stop to that, but he has to back himself away. The Caudal Blast plus the Wisp and his Spirit Balls are going to be able to force him back. Brewmaster can turn, though. He's going to go for the clap. One critical. If he can get this on Wisp, he can actually finish him off. And with the Lich Frost Blast, that's going to be enough. Big overextension there from Terra Firma as the two supports pursued, but just fed away an extra kill to the Brew.
Yeah, and that's what you were saying, man, that one position Brewmaster really does need to do some work for them. That's the kind of fight that he needs if For the Glory are going to come back into this game at all. But I still, you know, the one death, it's almost too late right now. It's almost too late to get that kill on the Tiny. You really need to kill him a couple fights in a row in order to knock him off this ridiculous farming pace that he's on.
Yeah, Aghanim's is such a great farming
tool. Another relocate coming in.
They're going to stomp. Actually lands on just one as the Juggernaut was able to get off his spin in time. And Centaur's taking a good amount of damage here. Pops the haste, though, in order to get out of the range of everything else. Viper's going to be taken down with a couple of right clicks. Another good initiation there, or counter initiation from the Brewmaster. But unfortunately, everyone is dead. There's no damage follow-up whatsoever. And now they're just going to focus on the Brew. They know he doesn't have his ultimate, so it's a simple source of just focusing him down real quickly and going right back to the tier 1 tower. Terra Firma taking a very early lead, 14-5, 16 minutes in, and this is going to be them taking probably a 10,000 gold lead by 20 minutes.
Yeah, and this is, to me, the biggest single problem with the one-position Brewmaster. You really, if you're going to run a one-position Brew, you really need to have a very strong farming mid or something like a Faceless Void offlane, because at least for much of the early game, before about 20 minutes or so, when Brewmaster's ult is down, he's nothing. And so you can easily have situations like that where you win a fight, but then the other team knows that Brewmaster's ulti is down, and you've got to have another hero that can really bring the fear in team fights, and they just don't. This Viper is too under farm. The Juggernaut wasn't really able to get much done. In fact, really kind of fed the Tiny in the offlane. They don't have anything behind the Brewmaster for when that primal split is down.
And now it's just going to be tower after tower. Is really the initiation is there for the Brewmaster, but again, he's kind of screwed out by the Centaur ultimate, the counter. And that means tier 1 tower is going to fall before For the Glory can actually mount a response here. And now they make it caught out. Jarl's been able to find Viper on the side. Will be able to land the stun. Now the follow-up, and they get a bolt there. No Brewmaster ultimate is going to come out in time. Well, he gets it off barely. That is good. Chainfrost is bouncing around quite a bit, but at the same time, For the Glory, they're having a hard time locking down these heroes. Paris is getting low. Looks like the Brewmaster ultimate is going to be able to finish him off in a short amount of time. At the same time, Juggernaut has gotten both the Keeper of Light, but now he turns up against the Tiny, gets stunned up, and now going to be right-click down. The Healing Ward can't possibly save him. And Paris actually successfully kited the Brewmaster around enough that the Brew ultimate went down. And he turned and killed him with the Exorcism, just barely keeping himself alive. But Paris, well played. I thought he was out of it completely. But the Yule Scepter, plus the max movement speed from Drums and his Phase Boots being used, got him out in time. And pretty much nobody died for Terra Firma. They lost the Keeper of Light, but gained so much out of that fight.
Yeah, and this is just what happens when you let a Tiny get ahead. A little bit of a misplay by For the Glory there at the beginning of that fight. They grouped up at the beginning, and Tiny was able to land that multi-man stun and really just get that cleave going, just doing tons of damage. But then the Brewmaster got his split off at like 30 HP, and they were able to turn that fight a little bit, but just couldn't finish. Just because these heroes now for Terra Firma have their levels, they have their farm, they have the items that they need, and For the Glory really don't. It's just that simple.
Yeah, I mean, they're all the cores are built tanky, right? They're two strength heroes plus an intelligence hero that loves to be able to tank up. So you go for like a good stat item like Drums, Yules, increase your survivability. What a stun there! And the Avalanche combo. No Brewmaster ultimate, nothing to save them. Witch Doctor ultimate will be able to force Terra Firma back, but that is still two cores going down for the Glory. And an early GG call.
And I don't mind this. I would have liked to see a slightly longer match, but they just can't survive these multi-man stun initiations right now. I mean, you just saw in that last fight that the Centaur was able to blink in, get two with the stomp, the Tiny came with the Avalanche, and that's instantly a 5v3 fight, and you're not going to come back from that. So, you know, a little bit of a lopsided match here, but I think you saw what Terra Firma is capable of, the way that they can execute. I think this is going to be a really exciting team to watch here going forward.
All right, guys, we're going to have a short little break. Remember, these are best of three, so we will have at least one more match or one more game from this match, and then we'll be moving on to our second match of the day for the MSI Fnatic Beat It Global, and that is going to be between PDB and Scenario. So stick around, guys. More Middle Eastern qualifier action coming up next.